In the day's other news, the Department of Homeland Security dropped its directive that international students in the U.S. attend college classes in person or leave the country. The announcement came at a federal court hearing in Boston. Harvard and MIT had sued, arguing the rule would force students to risk getting the coronavirus and cost the schools money. More than 200 other colleges and universities supported the lawsuit. Three states held primaries today amid the COVID-19 resurgence. In Texas, Democrats were choosing a challenger to Republican John Cornyn, a three-term U.S. senator. The state did not require face masks at the polls and did not expand mail-in voting. In Alabama, former U.S. Attorney General Jeff Sessions faced Tommy Tuberville for a Republican Senate nomination. And in Maine, Republican Senator Susan Collins awaited the winner of the Democratic nominating contest. President Trump has weighed in again on racial issues confronting the nation. In a CBS News interview today, he dismissed concerns about the Confederate flag and said, quote, people love it. He also criticized a question about black Americans being disproportionately killed by police by saying, quote, so are white people, more white people, by the way. The president also signed an order aimed at China's efforts to rein in protests in Hong Kong. The order strips the territory of preferential financial treatment. Meanwhile, China sharply criticized the U.S. for rejecting most of its territorial claims in the South China Sea. Beijing accused Washington of, quote, flexing its muscles and interfering in the region. Britain has reversed course and will ban Chinese telecom giant Huawei from its next-generation mobile phone system. The U.S. had pressed for the change, and the British government announced it today. Dan Hewitt of Independent Television reports.
The U.K. can no longer be confident it will be able to guarantee the security of future Huawei 5G equipment. By the time of the next election, we will have implemented in law an irreversible path for the complete removal of Huawei equipment from our 5G networks.
So why have the government done it? Well, Huawei may be the world's second largest supplier of mobile phones after Samsung, but the Chinese firm's equipment is also at the heart of the UK's mobile network, and it's their role in the newest technology, 5G, where the apparent security risks lie. In May, the US imposed sanctions on Huawei, who claimed China could use the firm to spy on them. And today, UK security services concluded they could not guarantee that using Huawei's 5G kit was safe. So the government will ban all telecoms companies from buying Huawei's equipment after this year and remove all their 5G technology from the UK by 2027.
We're disappointed by the announcement today. It wasn't totally unexpected, but the severity and the speed of the implementation we think will be a problem for the UK network. So it's not good news for UK consumers.
But major economies don't see you as trustworthy, and they believe you are ultimately answerable to the Chinese state.
We provide communication services to one third of the planet, so we are trusted.
Huawei will be allowed to carry on providing equipment for Britain's 3G and 4G networks, but the government admitted today that removing them from 5G would set the UK back 2 or 3 years and cost the phone companies £2 billion.
Ultimately, it's very likely the consumer is going to pay for that, and the consumer is going to pay in terms of slower 5G rollout and kind of waiting longer for the benefits that ensues from that.
While this latest government U-turn will be welcomed in Washington, attention will now turn to reaction in Beijing and the diplomatic cost of pulling the plug on one of its biggest names.
That report from Dan Hewitt of Independent Television News. In Bangladesh, seasonal monsoon flooding has now left more than 1 million people stranded or displaced. With major rivers rising, villagers in the north are using makeshift boats to get animals and belongings to higher ground. The water's flowing in from India upstream. The monsoon season begins in June and runs through October. Back in this country, meanwhile, the federal government carried out its first execution in 17 years. Daniel Lewis Lee died by lethal injection at a federal prison in Terre Haute, Indiana. He murdered three people in Arkansas in 1996 in a white supremacist plot. The execution went ahead after the U.S. Supreme Court lifted a lower court's injunction overnight. British socialite Ghislaine Maxwell pled not guilty today to luring young girls into sexual abuse by Jeffrey Epstein. She appeared in a video hearing before a federal court in New York. The judge denied bail for Maxwell and set a new trial date for next July. Her longtime confidant Epstein was facing sex trafficking charges when he killed himself in jail last August. Another federal judge in New York has rejected a settlement between Harvey Weinstein and his sexual misconduct accusers. The former Hollywood producer is serving 23 years for rape and sexual assault. He had agreed to pay $19 million, but the judge ruled today that the dozens of accusers are too varied to be grouped into a single settlement. Supreme Court Justice Ruth Bader Ginsburg was hospitalized today with a possible infection. A court statement says she's at Johns Hopkins in Baltimore after having a bile duct stent cleaned out. She's expected to remain there for several days. Ginsburg has had two bouts with cancer and been hospitalized several times in recent years. And on Wall Street today, stocks picked up steam after a slow start as investors again pushed aside concerns over COVID-19. The Dow Jones Industrial Average gained 556 points to close at 26,642. The NASDAQ rose 97 points, and the S&P 500 added 42. Still to come on the NewsHour, Bernie Sanders discusses the race for the White House and Biden's plan to combat climate change. The Centers for Disease Control faces increasing scrutiny for its handling of the pandemic. The struggles of community college students burdened by COVID-19 and structural inequality, plus much more.
This is the PBS NewsHour from WETA Studios in Washington, and in the West from the Walter Cronkite School of Journalism at Arizona State University.